Good morning.
Good morning.
If you would turn with me to the inside of your bulletin, we'll go over this week's announcements. This evening, we will begin our fall schedule. And so at 5 o'clock, we will have youth ensemble, and then the children's choirs, the youth, and the discipleship training classes will begin at 6 o'clock, and then the handbell choir will meet at 7. This is a Cookie Monday, so if you are on the September Cookie Brigade, if you could bring cookies to the office by tomorrow at noon. Also, Wednesday night is potluck, so there is a business meeting, so if you can remember that, to bring a dish with you on Wednesday nights. Next Sunday, there will be a deacon ordination, and we look forward to that and hope that you will attend. Inside your bulletin, you will find the Brotherhood Disaster Relief Packet list again, and also a list of some disaster relief addresses if you are interested in sending money directly to them. Also, we received an email this weekend from the Kentucky Baptist Fellowship, and they will be sending a disaster relief team on Monday, September 26th through Sunday, October 2nd to Alabama. If you are interested in attending that trip, please let us know and we can get you in touch with John Lepper, who is in charge of the Kentucky Baptist Fellowship, in order to attend that trip. They are also looking for volunteer drivers, church vans, and individuals. And also, all the participants need to be over 18 years of age. So if you are interested in that, and also this address that you have listed for the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship, you can also send money directly to relief teams. And there is a Kentucky address if you're interested in sending money directly to this relief team, the Kentucky relief team. So just let us know if you're interested in any of that. If you'll please read about the breakfast meeting on Friday, it is with the president of Georgetown College. If you are interested in that, we do need to make reservations if you want to attend that meeting. The Children's Mission Day is October 1st. Today is the last day to sign up. So if you're interested in your child going to that, first through sixth grade, please let me know as soon as possible. So let's now take some time to prepare our hearts for worship.
We sing this morning a medley of praise. You find in your hymnal, you start on hymn 215, and we'll sing the following two hymns. They're in your bulletin. It tells you which verses. On 216, we'll sing verses 1 and 4, and on 217, we'll sing verses 1 and 3. And we'll start, and they'll go right after each other, and all you have to do is turn over in your hymnal. Would you stand, please, and join us in singing?
Thank you.
morning I'd like to read from Psalms 95:6. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, this morning as we gather to worship You, prepare our hearts and minds that we might be eager to praise You. Prepare us to hear the word that You might have for us this morning in this service, whether it be through song, scripture, through the message that Mary brings us. And this morning we also lift up Chuck as he's in Litchfield, Kentucky, where he's returned, where he was the first pastorate he had. And we lift him up this morning as he brings Your word to that group down there. Remember, help us to remember that worship is about You, Lord, and not about us. So help us to clear our minds that we might be eagerly praising You this morning. And hear our prayer as we pray the prayer that Your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Children, if y'all come down, I'd like to tell you a story, okay? Come on down here. Just have a seat. Well, I'm glad y'all came down. I would like to tell you a story. Hey, Will. Good. Hey. Hey, how are you doing? I've got a treasure chest here. What do you think's in there? Gold. Maybe. That's what the gold and diamonds, that's what you would think, but this is a different kind. Huh? All kind of stuff there might be in there, right? Well, he's going to surprise you what's in here. Let me show you what's in here. Well, what's that?
A bottle.
Let me tell you a story about this bottle and why it's a treasure, okay? When I was maybe a little older than y'all, when I was in Cub Scouts, we had to make a Christmas present for your parents. So this was my Christmas present. Not much of a present, huh? But at the time, I thought it was a really nice present. I painted the lid green, and it's a prune juice bottle, which I guess is the lowliest of all juices, probably. But anyway, it was supposed to be a water bottle for my mom so she could put it in the refrigerator. This is back before the time of bottled water. You'd put a bottle of water in there, it'd get cold, and it'd be good to drink. It had measurements on the side, so. A good place for a pet turtle, right. Yeah. Well, anyway, as time went on, I thought, boy, this is a good present. But you know what? It got closer and closer to Christmas Eve. I thought, man, that's not much of a present. I'm a little bit worried. It got Christmas morning, and I started to give it to my mom. And I said, Mom, you won't like this present. She said, oh, I will. I like it. I said, no, you won't. You won't like it. She said, oh, yes, I will. She opened it up, and you know what she did? Like all good moms do, she said, oh, that's a great present. She made me feel like it was silver or gold or diamonds, like you said. And you know what? No, I don't know. But anyway, about 40 years later, you know what I found? Way up on the shelf in our house, we were cleaning the house out, I found this bottle. And you know what that meant to me? It meant that she really liked that bottle. It wasn't, do you think it was because it's expensive? No, it was because it signified love, didn't it? It represented love. And there was a little note on there. It said, water bottle from Mark Watson to his mom, first grade. I'm not sure if it was the first grade, but that was close. So here, then there's another treasure. Now this is expensive, I bet. Now I'll tell you where this stays. It's a bird, yeah. You think it's made out of gold? Maybe? No, probably not. But anyway, I'll tell you why it was a treasure. This was a treasure because Daniel, our son, picked it out in Parents' Day Out, I think, probably Alvina was there when he picked it out. They went to the store and they picked it out and he picked this out for his mom. So guess where this has stayed? And guess where it better never be taken from? And Deborah probably wonders where it went this morning, so I didn't tell her we were doing this. But anyway, it was a treasure to her. It was a mommy present, that's right. And that meant a lot to her. And the reason that was special, not because you could sell it, I don't think anybody in here would buy this stuff, would they? they wouldn't buy this stuff, but it was a treasure because it was an emblem it showed his love for her, and that meant a whole lot to her. Now, you know, it's real easy to please your moms or your dads. You give them little things, and they really appreciate it for all their life. You never know what I mean. And you never know what little things will do for someone. When you do a little something, they'll appreciate it for the rest of their lives. But you'll find as you get a little older, sometimes you try very hard to please people, and they're not impressed. They don't appreciate it, and it really hurts you. But you know who loves you even more than your mom or dad? Can you imagine that? Somebody loves you more than your mom or dad? Is that human? That's right. Jesus, God, it's not humanly possible, but it's only possible because Jesus loves us very, very much. And the Bible tells us that if you do something for someone, even if they're not very important in worldly standards, it really is like doing something for Jesus. And you know what I think? Now, this part is not in the Bible. This is something that I'm guessing, but I think this is true. When you do something for somebody, when you do something that you love somebody and you do it for them, you're actually doing it for God, for Jesus. You know what I think he does? Do you think he has a chest like this he puts it in? I think maybe he takes it in his big, strong hands, he puts it in his heart, and he saves it. And one of these days, when you go up there to heaven, he'll look at you and he'll say, "My dear little child," because that's what y'all will be. Even when you're grown up, we're all his dear little children. He'll "Sweet dear little children," that's right. Oh, that's nice, isn't it? He'll say, "I love you so much because look what you did for me when you did that for someone else. You made a treasure that I'll keep in my heart forever." So remember that. Put that in your heart and remember that when you do something for someone else, you know who you're actually doing it for? Who are you actually doing it for? You're doing it for Jesus, aren't you? And remember that this week, okay? Yeah. Well, this box is actually a treasure because it was something that my son and I made together, okay? So that makes it a treasure. It does. It's nice. Now let's say a prayer, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for these dear children. I thank you for the gift that you've given us in their presence. And I thank you for the lesson that they teach us when they come to us and they give us things so freely, not because they're expecting something back, just because they love us. And help us to be like little children, Lord. Help us to do things for other folks, because when we do, we're doing them for you, Lord, not because we're expecting something back, but just because we want to give you a treasure to keep in your heart. Amen.
We're glad you've chosen to be here today and worship at First Baptist. We'd like to recognize our first-time visitors, and as our regular attenders and members stand, will you remain seated so that we can meet you and say hello? And then as soon as we've had a chance to do that, we'll all stand and sing together. If you'll take "Trust in the Lord" out of the middle of your bulletin. This is an anthem that the choir has sung, and we want you to learn it too. And so you'll have that to sing with us. Would you stand and greet each other? be seated.
If you will turn with me to Psalms 119 as we read together verses 97 through 112. Psalms 119, verses 97 through 112. Please read with me. Oh, how I love you, your law. I meditate on it all day long. Your commands make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more insight than all my teachers, for I meditate on your statutes. I have more understanding than the elders, for I obey your precepts. I have kept my feet from every evil path, so that I might obey your word. I have not departed from your laws, for you yourself have taught me. How sweet are your words in my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I gain understanding from your precepts, therefore I hate every wrong path. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it, and I will follow your righteous laws. I have suffered much. Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept, O Lord, the willing praise of my mouth, and teach me your laws. Though I constantly take my life in my hands, I will not forget your law. The wicked have set a snare for me, but I have not strayed from your precepts. Your statutes are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. My heart is set on keeping your decrees to the very end. Let's pray. God, we do thank you for your word and the chance to be here today to learn more about you. We lift up those who are sick and those who are hurting. We take time today to remember the families of 9/11 who today sit in memorial services in remembrance of their loved ones. Today is a hard day for them, and we pray that they can feel your comfort and your presence. God, we remember the victims of Hurricane Katrina. We pray for those working with them throughout the Southeast. God, we take time now to know that there have been moments this past week that we have not obeyed your laws, that we have not obeyed your precepts, and we confess those times of failure to you now. Thank you, God, for your forgiveness, that you are the great Redeemer. Lord, we pray that this week we will live lives that are pleasing and honoring to you. In your precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Our offertory hymn is a song of God's care for us. The hymn is Day by Day. It's hymn number 66 in your hymnal, if you'll join me in Stand and Sing.
Thank you.
I'd like to read a selected passage from 2 Corinthians 9 as we prepare to give of our offerings this morning. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of God's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. And as we give this morning, let's remember that it is in thanks to God for all the many blessings that we have received. Dear Heavenly Father, we humbly come before you this morning, and we are so blessed. And we know we're blessed because of you. And our biggest blessing is your Son that you gave to us. And without whom we would have nothing. We would not have eternal life. But you also expect from us in return a measure of thanks and giving. And we pray this morning that our blessings will be honorable and pleasing to you. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Thank you.
you will please turn with me to Genesis chapter 50. So we read together verses 15 through 21. Genesis 50, verses 15 through 21. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" So they sent word to Joseph, saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Last fall, Will and I attended the homecoming game at the University of Tennessee. During the wait of pregame and during timeouts, Tennessee features events and athletics in their own personalized commercials. One of these commercial series is entitled Tennessee Is. Usually these commercials feature words you would expect to be associated with football and other athletics, such as Tennessee is tradition, which would be followed with nostalgic photos and, of course, lots of orange paraphernalia. This week's commercial began with Tennessee is redemption. This was a little unexpected, a word with such religious connotations. However, for many people in Tennessee, volunteer football is a religion. This commercial featured James Wilhoit, the kicker for Tennessee. In the game the week before against the Florida Gators, Wilhoit had missed his first kick. This Tennessee kicker had never missed a field goal or a point after touchdown in his career at Tennessee. But he didn't just miss any kick. This was a crucial point after touchdown kick that would have tied the game with only a few minutes left. Every Tennessee fan was devastated. But as Florida gained the ball and the Tennessee defense did not give up, they stopped the Gators and gained possession with less than a minute to go. They were able to get within kicking distance. I guess you could say kicking distance. It was 51 yards away. James Wilhoit returned to the field. The center snapped the ball. All 100,000 Tennessee fans held their breath. Wilhoit kicked the ball, and immediately he knew. There was no doubt in his mind that he had successfully made this career-long field goal. The commercial in the stadium on the Jumbotron shows the tragic events of the seemingly game-losing extra point kick. Then the words, "Tennessee is," on the huge screen. The third scene was Will Hoyt's game-winning field goal. The final scene was a black screen with the word redemption written in orange letters. The crowd, of course, erupted in applause. James Wilhoit has experienced redemption, and the tragedy of the previous kick was all but forgotten in the wave of the win over the Florida Gators. The story of Joseph and his brothers is a familiar one. Jacob and his sons were in Canaan. The other brothers knew that Joseph was the favorite and were jealous of him. Joseph had a dream, and he told his brothers about it. In his dream, the brothers had bundles of grain. Joseph also had a bundle, but his stood upright as the others gathered around it and bowed to it. This only caused the brothers' hatred to increase. So one day, Joseph was sent out to check on his brothers, and they had plotted to kill him. His one brother, Reuben, convinces the others not to kill him, but to just throw him in a pit. Reuben had a plan to later rescue Joseph. But while Joseph was in the pit, the brothers saw a caravan, And they sold their brother to the Ishmaelites for just 20 pieces of silver. They ripped his robe and poured the blood of a goat on it and took it to their father, who mourned the death of Joseph for several days. While Joseph was on that caravan, he got sold again in Egypt to one of the Pharaoh's officials. He became the overseer of the house of Pharaoh's official. So he got this job because everything around Joseph seemed to prosper. However, the wife of the official tried to seduce Joseph, but his refusal caused her to frame him and the official to throw him in jail. The chief jailer, however, saw that things around Joseph always prospered, so he put him in charge of the prisoners. The Pharaoh's cupbearer and the baker also ended up in jail with Joseph in charge. And so they had dreams that Joseph interpreted for them. And through these dreams, they left the jail, but did not mention Joseph as he had requested to Pharaoh until 2 years later. Pharaoh has two dreams that he needs interpreted. And the cupbearer then remembers Joseph. And the Pharaoh sent for him. Pharaoh's dreams told of the famine to come and their need to store up food during the good years before the famine. Pharaoh believed in the wisdom given to Joseph by God and placed him as overseer of his house. Egypt was the only place to buy grain during the famine, and so Jacob had sent his sons to buy grain in Egypt, all of them but Benjamin. They got grain, but did not recognize Joseph. On the next trip, they brought Benjamin at Joseph's request, and during this visit, Joseph reveals who he is and tells them that they are only 2 years into the 7-year famine, and that he was put into the position so that he could preserve life by preparing Egypt and storing food. The family moved to Egypt, and this is the conclusion to that narrative, and that's what we find here in Genesis 50, a chain of events that can be described in no other way but ironic. A younger brother who is sold into slavery out of jealousy becomes the one whom they must come to at a time of need during this famine. A boy sold into slavery and later put in prison because of his dreams and the ability to interpret them. He finds himself later as the right-hand man to Pharaoh. He had forgiven his brothers for their mistreatment of him, but now after the death of their father, they are once again fearful, fearful of what revenge might come their way from Joseph. Revenge is a concept we're still familiar with today. What many people did not hear after this football game against the Florida Gators was the phone messages that were left on James Wilhoit's answering machine. He was left death threats after the first kick, and then several messages reneging those statements after the end of the game. How awful that revenge is sought over the kick at a football game. Revenge is the norm of our society and is almost expected behavior. It is more common to be upset instead of understanding, angry instead of forgiving. Will and I went to Walmart a week or so before we got married just to pick up a few things we needed for our honeymoon trip. So we were standing in the checkout line just talking about all kinds of things, final exams, the wedding, the honeymoon trip. We're not paying any attention to what's going on with the cashier. So I finally look down, and there seems to be some food items running across the scanner. "Whoa, that's not ours," I said, and started to laugh because Will and I just hadn't been paying any attention. The cashier looked up, wide-eyed with fear. I explained that we didn't get any groceries, and she had begun to ring up several items from the lady behind us. Both the lady behind us and the cashier began apologizing profusely. The lady behind us hadn't been paying much attention either. So after this, they were so fearful, and they were just waiting to see what our reaction would be. And Will and I continued to tell them that it was no big deal. As we sorted through the bags, the cashier returned the things that weren't ours. After we had paid, Will and I were loading our bags into our cart, and we noticed a head of cabbage that was still mixed in with our stuff. We separated it into its own bag, and we just turned around and placed it in the cart behind us. The cashier and the lady began to apologize again, The lady even tried to hand us money for the cabbage. We again told them both that it was no big deal, and we headed on out. I was shocked at the fear that seemed to overcome both of these individuals. They had so much fear that we would be irate at what had just occurred. Something that was a simple accident and an honest mistake. The woman behind us still wanted to give us money for the cabbage after we had given it to her. Us not being angry was something totally unexpected. These individuals seemed unable to believe that forgiveness was offered, to accept it, and relieve themselves of the guilt they were experiencing. Forgiveness is offered and sometimes not accepted or not believed. Joseph's brothers still did not believe that they were forgiven. Joseph had provided grain for them, the family had moved, and still the brothers didn't believe. Joseph once again explains his position. Joseph, in his situation, expresses no hostility, no hatred or built-up anger, but a confidence in God. God was in control. Even though his original dream is part of what angered the brothers and caused them to send him away, his dreams had also helped to put him in the position he was in. Verse 20 says, "You intended to harm, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." God's plans are bigger than us. I don't know if I could be that strong after all that Joseph had been through. How hard for his brothers to believe it after years of guilt and fear that was still with them at that very moment. They had been forgiven, but how hard it must have been to believe and trust that forgiveness, to hear that what they had done could be used for good. There was a bigger plan, a plan that was not known to the brothers, God's plan to put the family of Jacob through Joseph in a good place during the Egyptian Empire, a plan that neither the brothers nor Pharaoh could stop. How hard for us to understand why bad things happen, but maybe even harder to understand is the magnificent power of God that can take something that was intended to harm and change it, transform it, and intend it for good. This is echoed in other places of Scripture when hard times are present and it is impossible to believe that there is good to be found. Jeremiah 29:11 states, "For surely I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, to give you a future with hope." The exile situation that Jeremiah found himself in was not one that he wanted to be in, but God assured him that it would work out. In Romans 8:28, Paul says, "We know that in everything God works for the good for those who love him, who are called according to his purpose." Walter Brueggemann, in his commentary on this passage in Genesis, states, "The evil plans of human folks do not defeat God's purpose. Instead, they unwittingly become ways in which God's plan is furthered." We are so often in situations like the brothers, getting rid of Joseph and doing what is best for us at the time, and then feeling the guilt of our actions. Guilt that sticks with us even after forgiveness is granted. But even with our evil actions, God has a bigger plan for good. A plan far bigger than us and unknown to us. Our actions are redeemed, and God is forgiving. We are also at times the recipients of evil action. At a point when evil acts have been committed against us, even then, God's plan is good. God is a redeeming force, giving us a future with hope. In the movie Schindler's List, which is set in Poland during World War II, Oskar Schindler starts off with a plan to use the labor laws passed by the Nazis for capitalistic gain. He is able to employ Jewish workers at his metalworking business for a cost far less than other workers. He is out to make a profit. He is able to get what he needs through bribes and the befriending of Nazi officers. Through the process of employing his workers, he must save them from certain death on many occasions. The cost of saving them becomes greater and greater. At one of the last points, he pays out of his pocket for the workers. His business has become the manufacturing of ammunition towards the end, but he even makes them faulty in hopes of preventing other deaths. He does all he can and is absolutely broke by the end of the war, but he has saved several hundred Jews from death, and Schindler is a changed man. The Jews, who are absolutely powerless, often do not know where they are headed as they are called out on the list in hopes that they are found on Schindler's list. Schindler has a plan, and he takes them on a path to liberation, freedom, and redemption. God is our redeeming force, who can help us in any circumstance. God's plans for us are good if we will let him lead the way. Are you letting God lead your life? And are you accepting the forgiveness that he offers? Our hymn of invitation is number 287, Take My Life, Lead Me, Lord. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever.